okay. Okay, we're ready to sing to the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you.
To see you high
and lifted up, shining with the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, 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 I want to see you. Holy, 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 I want to see you. Let's get you open. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. I want to see you. I want to see you. Sometimes I feel that I could fight an army with just me and you, and there's no one could harm me. Oh, but sometimes I can feel a little shine. If then I need to know that you are there. That's why
I'm singing, be with me, Lord.
When I'm down,
be with me, Lord.
When I'm lonely, when I'm tired,
be with me,
I need you only.
Be with me, Lord.
When I'm down,
be with me, Lord.
When I'm lonely,
be with me, Lord.
When I need you, Lord,
me,
only God. I know you said that I would not be tested more than I could bear, and that you have my best. With everything that ever comes my way, I know you're in control. So hear me as I pray. I'm singing,
oh,
when I'm down,
be
when I'm lonely,
be
when I'm tired,
be
I need you only.
Be
when I'm down,
be
when I'm lonely,
be
when I need you, Lord. Now help me, Lord, to share what I've been given. Help me make a difference with this life I'm living. As I saw my neighbor where two treasures stood, help me know you promised you'd be with me, Lord.
I'm
lonely.
Be with me, Lord.
When I need you,
be with me, be my only God.
Okay, amen. P66,
sir. Oh, amen. I'll tell you what, these songs are. They started to just get me going. I was like, oh, come on, I want to start clapping. I want to start doing something. You know, it's encouraging. But before we start, welcome every one of you. It is so good to see each one of you. And also everyone who is online. I know a few of our brothers and sisters are having their own service as well this morning. In Aberdeen.
Amen.
And I'm so inspired. They have their first get together. Family groups are joining together and they've invited some neighbors as well. So our prayers and our thoughts are with you as well out there. I have a picture up here. If you could put this picture up. This is actually, he's a French guy. This day in 1974, the Twin Towers were just about being built, and they had built almost to their full height. But this French guy in 1974, Philippe Petit, what he did was he actually put I don't know, I'm not good at French names, but Philippe anyway, he put basically a huge line between the two towers, and it was 411 meters above the ground, and he walked across the two towers, and you can imagine what happened. There was all these people suddenly looking up, they seen this guy with these twin towers being built. He's just walking across. Obviously the police was there and everything was, I mean, the whole 1974, we're looking about 40 odd years ago, 50 years, I don't know. I can't work it out that much, but it's almost 50 years ago, whatever it is. So, he made a big highlight, and he was arrested because you're not allowed to do that. Anyway, kill yourself. Anyway, but he wanted to make a name for himself. So he thought, how can I get attention? And so he did this, and he was arrested. But then later on, he was basically said, okay, you're free to go, but you're not, you cannot do this kind of stuff anymore. I think he had a stern warning. Well, why am I sharing that? Because I think often in life, oh honey, may I have that water, please? Sorry. Often in life, we would like to do something that kind of, we stand out. There's a moment of victory. And I remember one time I was asked because I had the Middle Eastern face. They came and they gave me £20. They said, "Can we just take your picture and because we're going to put it up somewhere?" And I was like, "Yes, I'm going to be famous, yeah." And £20 for a student was a lot of money in those days. You know, it was like a week's of just food, McDonald's and whatever. We have these moments of I can do something and I can be famous. You know, people get to know about me. But the Christian life is different. It is God calls us and he takes us through a journey. And it's a continual growing and it's a continual progress. I'm so encouraged yesterday, which was Saturday, Mike Jarvis put a little request yesterday. Is anyone available to go and share their faith? And I was in, I drove to Paisley, and I was in Paisley. Was that a good place? Paisley a good place? Paisley a good place. Anyway, I was there, Mike came over, and there was Kim Fernanda's husband. He called, and he said, yeah, I'm a little bit further away, but I'd like to come. So he came over, we sat down, and we talked, and I asked him, how has been almost a year and a half of your journey as a disciple? And he expressed how much he had learned and grown and moved forward. And it was such a joy to see that steady curve of just growing. And he was so eager, you know, he was asking, how else, what else can I do to become even better? And it was so heartwarming to see his conviction growing. And I think that is what God is calling us. And I'm so glad to be able to read this scripture to you, because the Christian faith is all about continual growth, continual perseverance. The scripture says, for this very reason, because God is calling us, keep this good journey. Make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness, knowledge, and to knowledge, self-control, and to self-control, perseverance. It's always there, this word. And to perseverance, godliness, and to godliness, mutual affection, and to mutual affection, love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I loved how Peter finishes this up. He says, therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and your election. For if you do these things, you will never stumble, and you will receive a rich welcome into the kingdom of God. And I think all of us who've made the effort to be here this morning, we all come from different backgrounds and journeys. But it is so good to see that we are making every effort to add and allow God to help us and to build us, because we want to make sure when we see the Lord, we receive that rich welcome. So I'm really encouraged and I'm really inspired that we can be all here together, because today we're going to have, Adam will take us to the communion, to the cross, so that we can remember the impact of Jesus going on the cross and what an incredible blessing that is to our hearts. And then we're going to hear from Scott how we can be inspired from Zechariah chapter 13 to really apply it to our lives, so that we can continue in this great journey towards God. Let us take the service to our God in heaven, and then we'll continue on with the worship. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much that our lives is not a moment of a burst and then kind of fizzle out of life, Lord. But it's a calling, Lord, to continue to walk with you. And we thank you, Father, for the church. Because in the church, Lord, we get the encouragements, we get the training, we get the help we need, so that, Lord, we can continue to persevere and add, Father, to our journey with you. We pray that this morning, Father, will be a worship that you, it will be honoring to you, and it will also help us to draw close to you. We pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. I believe in Psalm 95 it says, sing a new song to the Lord. So basically that's what we're going to be doing just now. We're going to be singing a new song to our Lord, which is, oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus. The words are absolutely gorgeous. And so is the tune. It's one of my my favourite melodies in all of hymnary. I learnt it about 30 years ago. More years than I care to remember. But amen. It goes like this. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, vast unmeasured, boundless, free, rolling as a mighty ocean in his fullness, over me, underneath me, all around me is the current of your love, leading onward, leading homeward to your glorious rest above. Let's stand. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, spread his praise from shore.
He shields and protects us, dying told us he's his own. Now he lives as our intercessor, watching over us from his throne. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, love of every love the best. It's an ocean vast of blessing, it's a haven sweet of rest. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, it's a hem of heavens to me, and it lifts me up to glory, for it lifts me up to thee.
Hello, everybody. If you have a Bible, please open up to the book of Mark. Going to be in Mark chapter 7. So, question today, just before we share communion, is God interested in me? Is God interested in me? So Mark chapter 7. And we're going to find, we're going to look at a woman who may ask that question herself. Mark 7 and in verse 24, the Bible reads, Jesus left that place and went to the vicinity of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know it. Yet he could not keep his presence secret. In fact, as soon as she heard about him, a woman whose little daughter was possessed by an impure spirit came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek, born in Syrian Phoenicia. She begged Jesus to drive the demon out of her daughter. First, let the children eat all they want, he told her. For it's not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Lord, she replied, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. Then he told her, for such a reply, you may go. The demon has left your daughter. She went home and found her child lying on the bed and a demon gone. Have you ever questioned God's love for you? Why would God love me? What have I done? Why am I so special? What has God done? You know, what have I done that God should love me? That God should regard me as being special? That God should regard me as being worthy? Why would he do it? And there's times I've questioned that. There's times I've thought that about myself. I've messed up. I did this. I've messed up. I've done so many different things that aren't in line with what God would want me to do. So why would he carry on loving me? I'm not good enough. Surely when he called me, surely he meant to call the guy next to me. It was a mistake. It should have been the guy next to me. He was the good guy. Why me? I've definitely had thoughts like this. And I suspect I'm not the only one. I suspect other people have thoughts like this as well. In this passage, we see this woman, this Syrian Phoenician woman, beg Jesus for help. Jesus had come primarily for the Jews. Okay, to teach the Jews, to minister to Jews. Now, his mission was much bigger than that, but during his ministry, He focused on the Jews. Okay? And Jesus reminds her of that. I'm coming here, I'm talking to the Jews. And at first sight, this looks like Jesus being unkind. But actually, he's not. He wants to see who she really is. He wants to see where her faith is at. He wants her to be bold. He wants her to be audacious with him. He wants her not to give up. And her reply is awesome. She says, but, you know, I'll just have the crumbs. I'll just have the crumbs. You give to the Jews, you give to the people that whatever you're going to do for them, that's great. But I'll just pick up what's left. I'll just have the crumbs. And even with that crumb, Jesus can do amazing things. Those crumbs of faith, Jesus does something amazing. And as I was putting this together, I actually thought about further back in Jesus' genealogy. And I was thinking about Ruth, a woman who actually wasn't a Jew. She was a Moabite. And then she came back with her mother-in-law, Naomi, and then she came and she started to glean the fields of Boaz. She started to pick up, not the crumbs, but the leftovers. And suddenly, by her picking up these leftovers, this amazing story happened, and she becomes the grandfather of King David. Grandmother. Gender issues. Grandmother. And she becomes this incredibly important person in the Bible, in Jesus. And David, of course, is in the lineage of Jesus. This is his own relative who picks up the crumbs. This foreigner picks up the crumbs and becomes part of Jesus' lineage. This woman here, another foreigner, she picks up the crumbs. And Jesus does amazing things with it. With these crumbs of faith. And she could so easily say, why me? What have I got? I'm not even part of your people. But Jesus does something amazing with that. He performs that miracle. It really doesn't matter where you're from. Jesus can do amazing stuff. Jesus got what he wanted to see, that audacious faith. Jesus wants to see your faith today. Maybe you feel that you're not worth much to God. But our feelings can be deceptive. What we feel is often not reality. The Proverbs say, the heart is deceitful above all things. Who can understand it? What we actually feel and the reality of the situation are often a polar opposites. We are worth so much to God. And what does all of this got to go and do with the cross? Well, Jesus came here and he died on the cross so we could be forgiven and we could inherit eternal life. So we become, through that event, when we choose to be reconciled back with God, we become a child of God, an heir to heaven. Isn't that incredible? Isn't that incredible? You know, God, our value to God doesn't change. You actually can't change your own value to God, but we can change our response to it. We can have faith in the cross and live a life in response of the value that you have in God's sight. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, just as we take up communion today, I pray, God, that you help us, God. Help us to reflect on that incredible value that you have, God. Help us also be inspired by this woman we read about in the Bible. Help us, Father, to have faith, to be audacious, God, in our faith with you, God, to be bold. I pray, Father, that you help us. Help us, God, not to rely upon our emotions, God, but to rely upon you, to trust in you and not in ourselves, God. I struggle with that, God. I struggle with not relying upon myself and rely upon my emotions, because my emotions can feel so real in the moment. And yet, God, in hindsight, I often understand how they were incorrect. God, help us, Father, to put our faith in you and be totally dependent upon you, God, totally secure in the value that we have in you in the cross. Thank you so much, God, for this. Thank you, God, that we take the bread and wine that represents Jesus' blood and his body. Help us remember Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.
While the bread and wine is being passed around still, we'll sing above all. We're on the main sheet for this song.
Above all powers, above all kings, above all nation, all created things, above all and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, crucified, lay behind a stone. You live to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, lay behind a stone. You live to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall and more of me above all. You were crucified and lay behind a stone.
rejected alone, like a rose, but on the ground, you took the floor. I thought of me above all. Please take that, stand and sing. Thank you for the song before. sorry. Anchor for the soul, shelter from the storm. Thunder and the lightning can be very frightening, but God is in control. Anchor for the soul.
One, two, here we are. I'll pick that thing up in a second. All right, good morning. I'm Scott, if we've not met, hello. Let's just get to it. This is going to be one of the longest sermons I've ever done, and I apologize. But there we are. This is the condensed version, so at least take care there. We've got some slides over here. Can we get like the lights off over here, if that's possible? Appreciate that. The slides are just visuals so that you don't fall asleep, but they'll be going on over there, and hopefully the time will just fly by, and you won't notice that the coffee's getting cold and the sun's going down. So I'm just going to assume that you remember the first 12 chapters of Zechariah, so let's go ahead and jump in. Verse 1, Zechariah chapter 13. On that day there shall be a fountain opened for the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to cleanse them from sin and uncleanness. Okay, hold on. You can't start a chapter with on that day. On what day? So we're going to need to jump back a little bit to chapter 12 so we can find out where we are. But before we go there, I just want to point out this isn't talking about a specific day, a 24-hour period, but it's talking rather about a specific narrow window of time. It's a time that at least covers Jesus' crucifixion, the day of Pentecost, 7 weeks later, and then on to the persecution of the saints, and the revelation of the Messiah and God's new people through the destruction of Jerusalem. So that's kind of what chapters 12 and 14 of Zechariah prophesy about. So the word day represents the idea more of a generation. But we use the word day like that today. Back in my day, things were so much better. So we're used to that. So that's what it's doing here. So jump back to chapter 12. This is kind of where this time period starts. We're going to skip the first part of the section of prophecy, or we'll be here literally all day, and we'll pick up with verse 10. So it says, "And I will pour out on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of grace and supplication. They will look on me, the one they have pierced, and they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only child, and grieve bitterly for him as one grieves for a firstborn son. On that day, the weeping in Jerusalem will be as great as the weeping of Hadad-Rimmon in the plain of Megiddo. The land will mourn, each clan by itself, with their wives by themselves. The clan of the house of David and their wives, of Nathan, of Levi, of Shimei, the rest of the clans and their wives all by themselves. And then on that day, a fountain will be opened to the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to cleanse them from sin and impurity." So on this day, God pours out a spirit of grace and supplication. Chris looked at that last week, this supplication, begging for mercy. He pours this out on Jerusalem. Each family and tribe mourns authentically, each by themselves, separately, showing the conviction of their hearts. And a fountain is opened for them to cleanse their sin. It's available to the house of David, which is the royalty, the upper class of Israel, and it's available to all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, all the way down to the lowest person on the streets. Salvation is made freely available to all. And that fountain was opened on the day of Pentecost. We read about it in Acts chapter 2. God pours out his spirit on the apostles who start to speak in tongues. And we know from Zechariah 12 that a spirit of grace and pleas for mercy was poured out on Jerusalem, on the people, so that Peter's message to the crowd could be received into their hearts. And Peter preaches the gospel message for the first time. That's a photograph of him right there. And he concludes with this. In Acts chapter 2, verse 36, he says, "Therefore let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah." Remember what Zechariah chapter 12 said, "When they look on me, on him that they've pierced, me." God was saying that they would be piercing and killing him, God. And Peter connects the dots here for them, that Jesus was this one who was God, whom they pierced. And Acts continues saying, "When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, 'Brothers, what shall we do?' They were cut to the heart. Their hearts were turned to grief and mourning over Jesus and their murderous, rebellious deed in killing him. As Zechariah had prophesied, they had killed God's Holy One, God's Son, even God himself." And Peter replies, "Repent. Be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." And then jumping down, those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to the number that day. So the fountain was freely opened for all. Let's continue verse 2. God says, "On that day," same time period, "I will banish the names of the idols from the land, and they will be remembered no more, declares the Lord Almighty." The idols have been cut off and remembered no more. The idols that caused problems for Israel from when they took the promised land all the way up to the time of Christ are now gone. They're not worshipped anymore, and they haven't been since around the time of Christ. And they've mostly passed from knowledge. The only ones we really know about are the ones that we've dug up through archaeology and the ones recorded in scripture, like Baal, Molech, Asherah, Dagon. And if there's any others, then I'm just fulfilling God's prophecy by not remembering them right now. But no one worships them and no one honors them anymore. But more than that, this is saying that when the fountain which cleanses from sin was to come, idolatry itself would no longer be found among God's people. And that's so true. God's people are no longer defined by a territory, by a country, a physical nation where clusters of people could erect a temple for idol worship or anything like that. God's people are defined by their faith in Jesus. And his kingdom is not a physical place. As he said, it's not of this world. So faith in Jesus cannot coexist with faith in anything else, as much as light and darkness cannot be in the same place. It's impossible. And the New Testament apostles warn strongly against idolatry. Anything that you let matter more than the one who matters most is an idol. And it's the opposite of true faith in God. So be alert and don't allow anything to jeopardize your faith. Here's what I thought might be the top three relationships. You know, making these relationships priority rather than this relationship. Money, but money really means nothing. It's all our provision comes from God. And in this one, believe in yourself like you believe in God. How about die to yourself and live for God? So this is just modern day idolatry. That scary guy there is a false prophet, and that's where we're going to move into. The latter half of verse 2 there, God says, I will also remove from the land the prophets and the spirit of uncleanness. If anyone again prophesies, his father and mother who bore him will say to him, you shall not live, for you speak lies in the name of the Lord. And his father and mother who bore him shall pierce him through when he prophesies. Sounds a bit harsh, but it's worth noting that this punishment reflects that what the old covenant law says about punishing false prophets in Deuteronomy chapters 13 and 18. So it's not so much that the parents are taking offense and murdering their kids, but rather that their children have broken a very serious law of the land and would be executed for it. Ugh. Continues, on that day, every prophet shall be ashamed of his vision. When he prophesies, he will not put on a hairy cloak in order to deceive, but he'll say, I'm no prophet. I'm a worker of the soil, for a man sold me in my youth. And if one asks him, well, what are these wounds on your back? He will say, the wounds I received in the house of my friends. So that might be a bit cryptic, but we'll get into it. The last words of the Old Testament are these ones from Malachi chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. And it says, behold, I will send you Elijah, and that's a photograph of him, the prophet, before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. And he will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with a decree of utter destruction. Day of the Lord, destruction, same thing. And then Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, verse 13, for all the prophets and the law prophesied until John, the Baptist. He didn't have that title then, but that's how we know him. And if you're willing to accept it, he is Elijah who is to come, fulfilling what Malachi was saying there. So, yeah, we're not there yet, sorry. So John the Baptist, that's him there, was the last prophet of the Old Covenant. There was to be no more prophets for the Old Covenant Jews because all the prophets foretold the coming Messiah, who was Jesus. And John was the one who announced that the Messiah had finally come. When it talks about a hairy garment of a prophet, the hairy cloak thing, this was the rough clothing that Elijah, Elisha, and John the Baptist wore. But the word there for garment or cloak, if it's used by itself without an adjective to describe it, actually suggests clothing of beauty and honor. And so the prophet's attire might have been simple, but the image it conveyed was one of great dignity. So by wearing these clothes, people would recognize them as a prophet and then listen to them. A bit like these people here, the white coat that a doctor or a scientist wears, or the various religious robes that priests wear. It symbolizes authority, that what they say can be trusted, but ultimately it means nothing because authority and trust lie within the bounds of truth. And if you're not being truthful, then you shouldn't have any authority and you shouldn't be trusted. The man in this example is acting just like that. He's impersonating a prophet by wearing this garment for whatever reason, probably his own selfish gain, whether through money or status, recognition, power, control over people, whatever it is. And it says that he'll deny he was ever a prophet, that he's always been a farmer or another laborer. He's covering up for his deeds because he's ashamed of what he's done, or he's scared of being seen as a false prophet because of the consequences. When it talks about the wounds on the back or the chest or hands, I wasn't going to put up images of wounds, it indicates that he was a pagan prophet. So there's some shamans there for you. Pagan prophets would often cut themselves as part of their rituals. Leviticus and Deuteronomy warn against the practice. And if you remember the showdown between Elijah and the prophets of Baal, it records that they cut themselves from morning to night until they were covered in blood. We don't really know why they did that. We can sort of fill in the gaps that maybe they were trying to cause their god to take pity on them or intervene before they went too far or whatever. But in this verse, the prophet here betrays himself as a pagan prophet because of these scars and wounds. God's people didn't have these marks, and he covers them up with a lie, saying that he got them just by playing rough with his friends, sort of thing. So these scary false prophets are gone in the same way that the idols are gone. False prophets among God's people are not part of God's people because they lie in his name and do not have the faith which would make them people of God. Light and darkness can't coexist, and so these can't coexist. Yeah, prosperity gospels. Ugh. It's also worth noting that the idea of a hairy cloak in order to deceive, you might be reminded of Jacob and Esau. Jacob's name literally means heel, because when he was born, they were twin brothers. He was holding his brother's heel, so he's the younger brother there. And after Jacob deceives their old and hard of sight father, Isaac, by pretending to be his hairy brother, Esau, by wearing a hairy cloak, Esau gives the name Jacob the negative meaning of cheater or deceiver. Or perhaps more literally, the idea of someone that sticks out their heel to trip someone else up. And that's a great segue, heels, for where we're going to go next in the text. So let's jump into verse 7. It says, "Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, against the man who stands next to me, declares the Lord of hosts. Strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. I will turn my hand against the little ones." And this gets its fulfillment in the New Testament. You'll all be familiar with this. The night Jesus was betrayed, they went out and sung a hymn, and they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I'll go before you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Oh, even though they all fall away, I will not." And Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this very night before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." But he said emphatically, "If I must die with you, I will not deny you." And they all said the same. And then later when he's arrested, Jesus says to the crowd, "Have you come out as if against a robber with swords and clubs to capture me? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching and you didn't seize me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled." And they all left him and fled. And so the disciples were scattered for a day or two. And then after Jesus' resurrection, he appears before them. It says, "On the evening of that day, on the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, 'Peace be with you.' And when he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, 'Peace be with you.'" I love that the first message of Jesus to his disciples after his resurrection and after they'd been scattered was, "Peace be with you." This is a historic moment. This is the first time that God declared his peace with mankind after having just made peace through his death on the cross. Paul talks about this in Ephesians chapter 2. He says, "But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in the place of two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off and peace to those who are near." Genesis 3:15 has the oldest prophecy about Jesus, which came from God cursing the serpent in the Garden of Eden, saying, "I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel." So Jesus is the shepherd who was struck. He was struck on his heel. The heel representing here his physical body, which was crucified. Your heel has a lot of value to you, but not ultimate value, in that you couldn't live without it. Whereas you can't say the same for your head, although the way we behave sometimes, you'd maybe wonder if we were trying to see if it was possible to live without our heads. You'll recover from your heel being struck, but a crushing blow to the head spells the end for you. And so the cross signifies Satan striking Jesus' heel, but also Jesus crushing Satan's head. Jesus' blood made the forgiveness of sin not only possible, but freely available without requiring any effort on the part of mankind, except acceptance. This destroyed any hope that Satan had of winning against God. It was God's ultimate move, the final checkmate, the crushing blow. Love it. So Satan struck the heel of Jesus in a poetic sense, his body. But also remember that Jacob means heel. And Jacob's name got changed to Israel, which became the name for the entire nation. So Israel, Jacob, heel, was also a heel that Satan struck. Satan gained control of the Jewish organized religion. The religious leaders were the ones who strayed so far away from God that they schemed to kill Jesus. They persecuted the early Christians, and they're referred to many times in the New Testament as the synagogue of Satan, or as we'd say, the church of Satan, Satan's stronghold. And on the day of the Lord, which chapter 14 gets into, when God came in judgment on Jerusalem for rejecting the Messiah, Satan, you could look at him as the shepherd of evil over the Jews. He was struck and his sheep scattered, but this time forever. The old covenant was brought to a complete end in that event. Jesus had fulfilled the requirements of the law and brought in a new covenant, but there was a crossover period of about 40 years where worship at the temple was still ongoing, and all their feasts and all of these things, the sacrifices, were still possible to carry out. But when the Romans destroyed the city in 70 AD, everything in the temple was destroyed as well, and that included the family records, the genealogies of all the different tribes. Without these, no one could prove that they were a Levite, and only the Levites were ordained to carry out temple worship by law. So since the destruction of Jerusalem, Jews have not been able to worship God as commanded in the old law, and it will forever be impossible for them. It's over. So Jesus crushed that head of Satan there. But Satan's got a few heads, at least poetically. He's a bit of a hydra. Satan's also the ruler of the world. That's what Jesus called him, not of earth, but of the world. And just as salvation came first to the Jews and then the Gentiles, judgment came first to the Jews and then the Gentiles. The judgment for the Jews rejecting the Messiah has taken place. The time for the judgment of the Gentiles is rapidly approaching. The day of the Lord is coming again, not just on Jerusalem, but on the entire world this time. And Satan's head at that point will be crushed completely and finally. The righteous will be saved, the wicked will be condemned. But there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. God is patient, not wishing that anyone should perish, but that all might be saved. So if you're listening today and you know that you're not right with God, please be courageous. Do whatever you need to do to accept the peace that God extends to you. For everyone else who knows that they're right with God, and it is something that we can know, let's do all that we can to work together to get the message out there to everyone who isn't right with God. Amen. Jesus came to seek and save the lost, and as he is, so are we. Let's move on. So it goes on to in verse 8, in the whole land, declares the Lord, 2/3 shall be cut off and perish, and 1/3 shall be left alive. I think it's safe to say that 2/3 and 1/3 here indicate that a major portion of the people would not be obedient to God and they'd be removed from his people, which we kind of just talked about. But a smaller portion would be faithful and remain. That much is obvious to us, but there's more to this fraction of thirds, which I think is significant. Bear with me. Deuteronomy 21, there's this interesting law here that says, if a man has two wives, the one loved and the other unloved, and both the loved and the unloved have borne him children, And if the firstborn son belongs to the unloved, then on the day when he assigns his possessions as an inheritance to his sons, he may not treat the son of the loved as the firstborn in preference to the son of the unloved, who is the firstborn, but he shall acknowledge the firstborn, the son of the unloved, by giving him a double portion of all that he has, for he's the first fruits of his strength. The right of the firstborn is his. So I believe that this two-thirds, one-third that we see here in Zechariah is an indication of sonship, of firstborn son and younger son. After the pattern in Deuteronomy, if a man had two sons, then their inheritance would not be split 50-50, but under this Old Testament law, it would be split two-thirds, one-third, because the firstborn gets a double portion of the others. Now, contrary to this law, the Bible has a pattern throughout Scripture of the younger son taking the status of firstborn. We see it in the family of Abraham. I think this was meant to be, it's probably Isaac's family, but let's pretend it's Abraham. We see it with the sons Ishmael and Isaac. Ishmael was Abraham's firstborn son of the unloved wife, if you will. He should have had the firstborn status, although this law wasn't around back then, but still. But instead, Isaac, the true son of his true wife, ended up taking the firstborn. And then you go down to Isaac's sons, Jacob and Esau. Esau was the older one, Jacob was the younger one. Esau sold his firstborn status, his birthright, to the younger brother, Jacob. So he took that on. And then up here we have Jacob and Joseph. Joseph was, again, Jacob's true firstborn son of his true wife, Rachel, the one that he loved. But Joseph was by no means the first. There was lots of children before then. But he ended up receiving the greater blessing that his brothers didn't get. And then this is a picture here of Joseph and Jacob and Joseph's two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh. And this is such an interesting passage when Jacob goes to bless Ephraim and Manasseh, giving them a sort of double portion instead of Joseph. He switches his hands around and says the younger shall serve the older. So this is just a weird kind of pattern that we've got going through Scripture. We can see hints of it with King David. He wasn't the oldest of his brothers, but he became the greatest. You see it with David's children, Solomon. Solomon was the second son of Bathsheba. Of course, the first one died. But David had other children. There was Absalom, who tried to usurp him, and all this sort of, it's Game of Thrones, honestly, read it, it's great. But Solomon became the king, and he continued the line through which Jesus would come. So this pattern of the older serving the younger, it really represents for us the new covenant Israel under Christ, which came and supplanted the old covenant of Israel under the law. It represents our new life by the law of the Spirit of Christ, supplanting our old life under the law of sin and death. But ultimately, it represents God's two literal sons, Adam, the first son of God, by whom sin and death entered into humanity, and then Jesus, the second son, but the true firstborn of God, who undid the works of Adam by destroying sin and giving humanity life again. So this is where this old becomes new theme works into it. So Jesus tells a parable about a man who had two sons in Luke chapter 15. He says, there was a man who had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the share of property that's coming to me." One third, remember. And he divided his property between them, two thirds, one third. Not many days later, the son gathered all that he had, and he took a journey into a far country, and there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he'd spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. And so he went, and he hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into his fields to feed pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, but no one gave him anything. But then when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise, and I'll go to my father and say to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and he came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him, and he felt compassion, and he ran, and he embraced him, and he kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe, put it on him, put a ring on his hand, shoes on his feet, and bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let's eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. And now his older son was in the field. And as he came and drew near the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, oh, your brother's come and your father's killed the fattened calf because he's received him back safe and sound. But he was angry and he refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him, but he answered his father, look, these many years I've served you and I've never disobeyed your command. Yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who's devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him. Ah. And then he said to him, son, you're always with me, and all that is mine is yours. The two-thirds, literally. It was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found. The younger son saw that he was lost and broken, and he came back to the father. But the older son couldn't even see that he was lost and broken because he thought he was safe in his father's house, even though he didn't love his father and he wasn't doing his father's will. If he was doing his father's will, he would have gone to rescue his brother because his father loved him and longed to have him back in the family. And that's what Jesus, the true older brother, came to do. So Jesus told this story to the younger and older sons in front of him at the time. There was the sinners, the tax collectors, who had ran away from God, but were hearing Jesus' message and coming back to him. But there was also in front of him the religious leaders, who thought they were safe because they'd never left home, but they were self-righteous and they were in danger of being cut off completely because they didn't have hearts for God. Jesus was pleading with them to change before the prophecy of Zechariah could be fulfilled against them. And so to sum up this section of Zechariah, when the shepherd is struck, the older son will be cut off and perish, the younger son will live. And this sees its fulfillment in that after Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, the old covenant was brought to an end, the disobedient branch of the old tree of Israel was cut off, and it perished, while the faithful root of the tree remained. And then the wild branch of the Gentiles was grafted into the tree. And this became the new tree of Israel. The old becomes new. But even though God foretells that this two-thirds will be broken off and perish, it's not the end of the story. God is still merciful and is still open to their repentance and actively working towards this. Paul explains it in Romans chapter 11. It's going to be a bit of a longer passage again. There's a lot of long readings today. Paul says, I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. For I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. Do you not know what the scripture says of Elijah, how he appeals to God against Israel? Lord, they've killed your prophets. They've demolished your altars. I alone am left, and they seek my life. But what's God's reply to him? I've kept for myself 7,000 men who haven't bowed the knee to Baal. So too at the present time, there's a remnant chosen by grace. But if it is by grace, it's no longer on the basis of works. Otherwise, grace would no longer be grace. What then? Israel failed to obtain what it was seeking. The elect obtained it, but the rest were hardened. As it is written, God gave them a spirit of stupor, eyes that wouldn't see, ears that wouldn't hear, down to this very day. And David says, let their table become a snare and a trap, a stumbling block and a retribution for them. Let their eyes be darkened so they can't see and bend their backs forever. And so I ask, did they stumble in order that they might fall? By no means. Rather, through their trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles so as to make Israel jealous. Now, if their trespass means riches for the world, and if their failure means riches for the Gentiles, how much more will their full inclusion mean? And now I'm speaking to you Gentiles. Inasmuch then as I am an apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry in order somehow to make my fellow Jews jealous and thus save some of them. For if their rejection means the reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance mean but life from the dead? If the dough offered as first fruits is holy, so the whole lump, so is the whole lump. And if the root is holy, so are the branches. But if some of the branches were broken off, and you, although a wild olive shoot, were grafted in among the others and now share in the nourishing root of the olive tree, do not be arrogant towards the branches. If you are, remember, it's not you who support the root, but the root that supports you. And then you'll say, ah, branches were broken off that I might be grafted in. That is true. They were broken off because of their unbelief, but you stand fast through faith. So don't become proud, but fear. For if God didn't spare the natural branches, neither will he spare you. Note then the kindness and the severity of God. Severity towards those who have fallen, but God's kindness to you, provided you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you too will be cut off. And even they, if they do not continue in their unbelief, will be grafted in. For God has the power to graft them in again. For if you were cut from what is by nature a wild olive tree and grafted, contrary to nature, into a cultivated olive tree, how much more will these, the natural branches, be grafted back into their own olive tree? So to conclude the sermon today, this is the shortest part of the sermon. You'll be relieved. Verse 9 actually gives us 3 points of encouragement, so that's where we're going to go. I'm also going to be pulling in some scriptures from 1 Peter here. There's a lot of correlation between 1 Peter and Zechariah 13, and I've been in 1 Peter a lot this week, so it's on my mind. The theme of 1 Peter is suffering for righteousness, suffering unjust treatment when you've done nothing to warrant it, and not responding to the attacks with more attacks, but rather staying loyal to God and man in the midst of your suffering. So point number one, and I will put this third, this is verse 9, I'll put this third into the fire and refine them as one refines silver and test them as gold is tested. God disciplines those he loves. The discipline is to refine us, to get rid of any way of thinking or acting that isn't from God, that isn't love. Help me out here. Someone give me a word that you would use to describe Jesus, any aspect of his character. Just shout something out. Mercy, grace, regal. What was that, Adam? Peace, truth, excellent. All of those things and more. This is how God sees us. This is how God created us to be. God created us to be purely good, without any spot or blemish or darkness. But like Adam and Eve, we mixed good with evil. And when God refines us, it's to purge that evil from within us so that we're fully living out what he planned for us, reflecting the image of God and not the image of Satan. Because Satan works hard to make sure that you're reflecting his image instead. The truest picture of what it means to be the image of God is found in the life of Jesus. He's our pattern. He's our example. So I'm going to read from 1 Peter 4, verse 12, to pretty much the end of the book. It's not long in this whole conclusion section because it's all relevant. So you can follow along there. The scriptures are on screen. It's all good. So verse 12 says, "Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery trial when it comes upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice, insofar as you share Christ's sufferings, that you may also rejoice and be glad when his glory is revealed. If you're insulted for the name of Christ, you're blessed, because the spirit of glory and God rests upon you." I love that. If people are hurting you because they see Jesus in you, it means they see Jesus in you. That's a great thing. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or a thief or an evildoer or as a meddler. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. For it is time for judgment to begin with the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is scarcely saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? Next part of verse 9 says, "They will call upon my name and I will answer them." This is a promise. God answers us when we call. We shouldn't suffer in silence. We should suffer crying out to God And God is always ready and waiting for us to act and move towards him. He wants to listen to us and to help us and to satisfy us according to his will and his goodness. 1 Peter 3 verse 12 quotes a bit of Psalm 34 saying, "For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous and his ears are open to their prayer." So continuing from verse 19 of chapter 4, Peter gives instructions for elders and shepherds on how to care for the flock. And the description here is how Christ cares for us. This is how the great shepherd who was struck, remember? This is how he looks after the flock of his people. He says, "Therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good." That act of entrusting us, calling upon his name, God answering us. "So I exhort the elders among you as a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, as well as a partaker in the glory that is going to be revealed. Shepherd the flock of God that's among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but willingly, as God would have you, not for shameful gain, but eagerly, not domineering over those in your charge, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the unfading crown of glory. Likewise, you who are younger, be subject to the elders. And clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility towards one another. For God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties onto him, because he cares for you." When we stop playing God, proudly and arrogantly deciding for ourselves what is right and what is wrong, what is good and what is evil, and we truly rely on him in all humility and come before him as our provider and the solver of our problems, then God listens to our pleas. And when it pleases God, he'll exalt us to give glory to his great name and because he cares for us. We're chosen by him and we're precious to him. And the last point here, the very end of chapter 13 says, "I will say, they are my people, and they will say, the Lord is my God." We are his people, and he's our God. This means more than anything in this life. Don't be distracted by anything that the world and Satan throws at you. They mean absolutely nothing compared to this, that we are God's. He is ours. We have everything of his, and he has everything of ours. There's a little bit in 1 Peter chapter 2 that says, "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you're God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." And then carrying on from where we were before, Peter ends by saying, "Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you've suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who's called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen."
Amen.
That's me.
Thank you so much. What a feast that has been.
Yes.
Can we have some lights on? That would be. That would be nice. I feel like it's quite dark. Dark here. I brought my computer today up the front with me. In fact, I brought it to church with me, as you know. A lot of information. I knew Scott was going to be preaching. Son of a teacher man, you know. He's got a lot of information. And I think it's always a good thing to take notes in church as well, isn't it? You know, sometimes if you look around, you'll see people occasionally taking notes. Nancy's got a little notebook there, and it's just a great culture to have. I mean, it doesn't say in the Bible you need to take notes in church, but it's just, you know, it just helps you remember things later on. Just, you know, you can go back and put it in your quiet times. And Today I brought the heavyweight apparatus because I'm teaching Zechariah 14 next week, so I thought better tie it on to what Scott said today. But that was fantastic. Absolutely great. Great sermon all round. Thanks to the song leaders. Thanks to Simon and Suzanne for teaching us a new song. That's great, you know, and just getting into that. That was really good. Thank you, Adam, for your communion. I thought that was really cool. Amen. Just tying in the Syrophoenician woman and Ruth and gleaning the grapes and picking up the crumbs. And, you know, that's really what we're really eligible to do from God anyway. But let's have that gratitude that he's really done that for us. Fantastic. And then thanks, Scott, for your sermon as well. You know, that fountain opened up for us. Yes. That's just a joyous thing. There is no hope for Satan. You know, and Jesus just making that peace with us through his resurrection. And the judgment's approaching. You know, that's true. We need to think about that as well. It's a joyous message, but the judgment is approaching. How are we going to deal with that? You know, let's make sure we're doing the Father's will. Mm-hmm. Let's make sure we're welcoming the prodigals into church. You know, that's so important. And that humbles us as well. That keeps us all on a sure footing of, you know, hey, we're all prodigals, really, you know. We're all the wayward son or daughter, whatever. But yeah, thanks for that. And let's just really take notes, commit that to our quiet times. These are fantastic scriptures just to get into and to get deep with. So there we are. I'm not going to make things even longer, but I do have some announcements to make, so I'll rattle through them. We've got the sisters in person here at Clyde Community Hall this coming Wednesday. Yes, so if you are a woman, any women here, come here. On 7:30 on Wednesday. Next Sunday I'll be preaching, that's a minor announcement. Family groups, the South family group along with Chris and Suzanne's family group are gonna be joining together this week. We're gonna go for a picnic barbecue down by the seaside, so that'll be quite nice. But do remember to just invite anyone who's studying the Bible, because we need to share our life and doctrine, 1 Timothy 4:16. You know, so let's share our lives doing that. If anybody would like to, we did have a bit of a chat on the group yesterday about doing a bit of evangelism. If anybody would like to do that, Chris and I will be there after church. I'm not sure where we'll go exactly. Maybe down Paisley Road West, maybe Elder Park, whatever. Depends who comes. If you'd like to do that, just hang out with us afterwards and we'll get on with that. And just one more thing, just like to ask for just prayers for just Walter and Jean Bryden. You know, not getting any younger. Let's just keep them in our prayers. Let's make sure, you know, they are covered in prayer for us. Jean is just for those of you who haven't met her, is a fantastic member of the congregation here. She's just not able to come due to health reasons, but she's absolutely with us in spirit. She's a prayer warrior of the church. Amen. Walter's not well just now either. So. Let's give the service to prayer. And then, will we have a final song? It's the Days of Elijah now, you know, it's a good one. Yeah, we're going to do it. Yeah, right, okay. We'll do that. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for a great service today. Great to just come before you, humble ourselves, listen to your word, really drink it in, God. Really be a team, be a community, be just hopefully, Father, just what pleases you, God. Help us to please you as a congregation. Just prompt us with your spirit if there's just any false way in us, God, and just help us just to do our best for you, God. We ask you at this moment, Father, for Walter Bryden and Jean Bryden. Please just look after them and just give them strength in you, God, and to draw to you in times of need, God. I just pray you'll be with Matthew Ndungu as well, Lord. He's still in hospital. Pray that you'll bring him back to us soon as well, God. But yeah, just everybody who has needs, God, please look after that. Just help us to live to your glory. Help us have the great rest of the service and the great rest of the day. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Over to you.
Amen. Yeah. By Scott, I was very, very amused by your reference to heels. About 5 weeks ago, unfortunately, I damaged my heel. So I've been walking with a walking stick for the last few days. So that was very funny. But anyway, Days of Elijah. Amen. Let's stand.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these days are great trials of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, shining like the sun, shining like the sun, a trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry oaks becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. Oh, these are the days of the harvest, for the fields are as wide in your world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding like a cloud, shining like the sun, a trumpet call. Lift your voice, to yet Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. There's no one like Jehovah, 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 there's no one like Jehovah. Oh, he comes, riding on the cloud, shining by the sun, a trumpet call. Lift your voice, year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, shining by the cloud, shining like the sun, a trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
Thank you.